Let us pray. Heavenly Father, God Almighty, in the times we live in, things are tough. Help us to be steadfast in following you. Do not allow us to deny you, but grant us the grace to overcome the evil one. There are many challenges, political, spiritual, religious, traditional, they are all around us. But in all, make us more than conquerors. Make us overcomers. Make us winners. So that your name and your name alone will continue to be glorified. We pray for Ifak, Nigeria. Lord, we pray that the work they do may prosper. We pray that they themselves may prosper. We pray that the peace of God may rule our hearts. The faith that has been committed to our charge, Lord, it will not be corrupted. We pray that from whichever angle the enemy is stretching his hand, cut it off in the name of Jesus. Do not allow the evil one to sow bad seed in our farm. Lord, we come to you. We trust in you. Do it for us and take the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. On behalf of all of us, particularly those of us in the Abuja area, I welcome you to this place. The Bishop of Gwagwalada must have welcomed you. We want to say that we are happy to see you, clergymen, in this number. By clergymen, I'm speaking inclusively of the women also. We bring you all greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank God for the journey mercies granted you from all over Nigeria and the glorious privilege to gather again this year, this time in the Diocese of Gwagwalada, to deliberate, fellowship, and commune in the presence of God. We wish to express our gratitude to the Bishop of this diocese, the Right Reverend Tanimu S. Aduda, for the open arms with which he has received us in his diocese for this year's convention. It is our prayer that God will, along this convention, pour his manifold blessings upon this diocese in Jesus' name. We further wish to appreciate the National President of IFAC, the Right Reverend Henry Okeke, and his wife, and his executive for the planning of this convention. May God reward your labor of love. All others who have in one way or another contributed to the planning and hosting of this convention, we say, may God bless you all in Jesus' name. I have written this thing, but I would like to speak from my heart. And at the end, we hope that we will put it in a magazine and it will be able to go around the country. Before I do that, let me say a few things. It is a great opportunity that God affords us whenever we gather in this manner as leaders of our church, leaving all other things, the routine ministerial work, to come apart to be with the Lord. After months of laboring, there is need for such a retreat to get spiritually refreshed by God in his presence and by his power. When Jesus called his disciples, one of the foremost reasons was that they may be with him. And after they had been with him, it was evident in their ministry that these men had been with the Lord. This is an opportunity to wait upon the Lord, that our strength may be renewed according to his promise. This is one thing Satan will not allow us to do. It will bring distractions from left, right, and center. But we owe ourselves a duty to resist the devil, and he will flee from us. We have spent money, time, and energy to be here. And while we are here, some other things will suffer. We should therefore make the most of this gathering, and God will bless our ministry in Jesus' name. I must appeal to us to be confined to as much as possible to the venue of this convention and not go on measuring the length and breadth of Abuja. That is not why we are here, brothers and sisters. God, in his infinite mercy and providence, is here to meet us as men and women of God, that we must open up to him. Let us present ourselves to him as husbands and wives, bring before him prayerfully the challenges we are facing in our different places of ministry. I'm confident that on this mountain, God will not let us go the same way we came. I therefore welcome you all to this mountain of transformation. In the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Now, be ye steadfast. Before the necessity to be steadfast is laid upon us. When you look around and consider the circumstances and the prevailing issues of the time, nobody will tell you that it is important to be steadfast at this time. When you talk about issues that oppress us, you are aware that Boko Haram is just asleep for now. And only not too long ago, a lot of people perished in Kano. And in that incident, three children from one father and mother died. And others like that. The Church of Nigeria sent us to Maiduguri to go and survey the land and see what is happening there. We went, or the archbishops and their representatives, with the help of the State Security Service, we were there. We visited the government, the traditional rulership, and Kan authorities, and of course our diocese of Maiduguri. You see tension. You see that it's an offense to some people for you to be a Christian. It's an offense. So this calls for being steadfast. And when the Kan secretary, Boronu State chapter, was killed, the daughter was begging them, leave the man. They killed him in the presence of the daughter. I say this because those of us from the south, we have become so complacent about Christianity that it has no value for us. And we are so much struggling after empty things. That journey to Maiduguri, ask your archbishop. Or if you have 5 minutes, ask Archbishop Akiemi to give you a rundown. When we got to the traditional ruler, the Shehu of Boronu, he was shaken completely because he said they are looking for him to kill him. And that they attempted to kill him in the mosque. And his shoe flew up from his legs, from his feet. He was there with the deputy governor, and the deputy governor's own was torn into pieces. In front of the emir's palace, where they were killing people, and so on and so forth. So do not think that the issue is over. It's not a 100 meters dash. It is a long distance running. And so, you need to be steadfast in your faith and get ready for whatever God allows to happen to the church at a time like this. It's happening in the north, particularly northeast, but it has spread all over the country. If you look around your corners, you will see shoe shiners. You will see people who cut nails. You will see cow rearers. You will see all sorts of people. They are the same group. And if you are not careful, you compromise your security, you place yourself on danger list. So, that is a very important reason why you need to be steadfast at a time like this. Furthermore, before, there was a problem over 10, 12 years now. The Anglican world had been in turmoil over homosexuality and lesbianism. Initially, the struggle was in the church, and they were struggling. At a point, the Church of Canada, the Anglican Church of Canada, and the Tech, the Episcopal Church, USA, or what we used to call ECUSA, they just refused to listen to anybody. And they went ahead and continued to do that. They went ahead and designed a liturgy for marrying a man and a man, a woman and a woman, and what is more, the liturgy for the burial of dogs. Dog. D-O-G. And on the day of, on Animals Day, dogs will receive Holy Communion with biscuit and a special drink. So the days are evil. Be ye steadfast. Not only that, the matter we were talking about, Canada, we're talking about the United States, now the thing has arrived in the UK. It's sitting down comfortably there. They have approved that they can make a bishop who is living a homosexual life a bishop. And as it turns out, the present government there is speaking neither to the left nor to the east. It's commending homosexuality, it's commending orthodoxy. So we don't know where he stands. That is the issue of the moment. And we have spoken in our retreat at Agbaroto when they took that decision that they could make anybody living in a civil partnership a bishop. We wrote to them to say, if you do so, you are not a friend of Caesar. Because we will not be able to follow you and we will not be able to relate with you. Now, having said that, let me add quickly that we do not hate anybody. The Church of Nigeria does not hate the homosexuals. We do not hate the lesbians. We are not even fighting a war with them. What we have said is that our theological position cannot accommodate that. We belong to where we belong, where we have always belonged, and where we will always belong. And it's very important for you to know that that teaching is not from God. It's not from God. There are many evil practices that you read about in the Bible. It is strange to know that they just picked one and canonized it, leaving the rest. Why is it that homosexuals are approved? Lesbians are approved when drunkards are not approved? Why? They are all in the same passage. Why is it that thieves are not approved? There are some people who steal for the fun of stealing, not because they are in need. Why have they not been approved? Prostitution is an age-long practice. Why have they not been approved? I know that they have even submitted their paper to the United Nations, asking to be recognized as a profession. Oh yes, they have. They have submitted their papers to the United Nations, asking for recognition for the profession of prostitutes. Prostitution as a profession. In South America, in some part of South America, they give them license, yes, to operate as prostitutes. So they are registered and licensed. But they are now going to the world stage so that the whole world will recognize them. And then we start talking about human rights of prostitutes. Very soon, maybe, may God forbid, it might be that they will say it is now right for someone to marry the sister or anybody around the family. The table of affinity will be disregarded. It is possible that dogs, since they are now taking Holy Communion, can now become canonized husbands. Because outside, somebody, a woman will own one dog, and that's all. Nobody, no friend, no anybody else. Be ye, the world is in a state of flux, and it's running on a terrible speed towards a very wrong direction. Back home here, we are confronted with what is now known as cultural revival. Cultural revival, the traditional mindset, they now want us to know that we have to be obedient to our forefathers and the way they lived, and so on and so forth. Sometimes when I watch our television, particularly the international media, that either the Voice of Nigeria, listen to Voice of Nigeria, or NTA 24 or 20 whatever, or international, it's only masquerade. I don't know whether you have observed it. They are only gathering masquerade to come and dance. Now, is that all that is in Nigeria? Is that all that defines us as a people? Other people are showing how they've done wonderful things in life. How they've built bridges. How they've done computer. How they've made roads. How they've provided water. And all this. Our own is to see people dancing masquerade every day. And so on and so forth. It's a very worrisome situation. And so those people will look at us. I was in Canterbury when the new Archbishop was enthroned. A troupe of dancers came from Ghana. And as part of the service, they were given 5 minutes to perform. After that, the reporter from the BBC, say that the new Archbishop was enthroned amidst a clandestine African dancing. That was all that they never reported anything about the enthronement. Nobody in Britain Even all the other televisions, no one said anything about the enthronement. I'm telling you, it was as bad as that. So they have forgotten everything about it. It doesn't make any meaning to them. Now, as if the cultural problem we have is not enough. I remember in part of my diocese before, we were ordered not to ring church bell. And in some places, you do not put on any light. And then, you are aware of what is happening in the Roman Catholic Diocese of Awka about burial and the tradition. It's not just the Roman Catholic problem. It's the same people who are in their church that is in our church. It's the people there's a resurgence of this traditional thought form and trying to challenge the church. So, if you are not sure what you are doing, you'll find yourself standing astride the culture. In the church, you are one of them. You are a chief. You are everything. In the traditional shrine, you are also a chief there. And so on. When there is evil to eat in the traditional system, you take your own. When there is Holy Communion, you take your own. Because if you get to heaven, whichever way there is room, you'll go there. That is the kind of idea that they have. That you shouldn't lose out. But the Lord knows those who are His. In our setting also, we have militant Islam. Militancy that is ready to start fight right now. Ready to cut off people's heads. While we were in Maiduguri, it was reported that in Biu area, over 30-something people were slaughtered. They will not just kill with a pistol or a rifle. They will cut the person like you are killing a ram and butcher. I remember when I was serving in Kaduna, a priest of the Baptist church was killed. They butchered him and packed him inside a wheelbarrow. So these are evil times. And the child of God, the minister of God, need to be steadfast in his faith. As if that is not enough, we have aggressive secularism. What is troubling America today is not so much of Islam, it's not so much of anything, but aggressive secularism. And secularism, properly defined, has no transcendental reference. That is to say, there is no room for God. There is no room for God. Everything is organized in a worldly manner. In that sense, it's an agent of the Antichrist. It's an agent, an instrument of the Antichrist. So, from America, we now have the push. Even the homosexual teaching has transformed from a way of life or a sexual orientation to a political ideology. So it's now homosexualism or lesbianism, because it has assumed a political theory. And so Obama, Cameron of UK, and Hollande, what is his name in France, they believe that they are the leaders of the Western democracy. and they must spread it everywhere. So at a time like this, you are the priest in the house of God. Like I said earlier on, if anybody comes forward and says, I have same-sex attraction, I need help, the help will be given. We will pray, we will counsel, we will support, so that the person will overcome the powers of evil in his life. But we are not prepared to receive the teaching that that is the way God has made me, so leave me alone. We will not leave you alone. We will help you to overcome the evil in your life. If you look at it, they are threatening hell, fire, and everything. But don't be alarmed. Don't be disturbed. After the Second World War, a group of theological scholars gathered and said that God was dead. That is what is commonly referred to as the death of God theology. And what they actually meant was that the room for God was getting smaller and smaller. And the room for science and technology was expanding. And very soon, science and technology and everything will wipe out the idea of God. And by then, God would have died. But the miracle, to God Almighty be the glory, is that today, those people have died. And God is marching on. They have died. And people like them will die. And God and His church will march on. There is also the setting of relativism. And all teachings associated with postmodernism. That if it is bad, it is bad in your own eye. It's not necessarily bad. There is nothing absolutely bad. There is nothing absolutely good. It depends on the way you look at it. And that is the teaching that the young generation of today is carrying about. So they don't want to see anything as wrong. They don't want to see anything as evil. They tell you it depends on the way you look at it. As for me, it's not. Or like this and like that. That is the moral attachment to aggressive secularism. And it's sweeping the world. If you are a pastor, whether in the city or in the urban area or in the rural area, this teaching is gaining ground. And how do you convince people that what is wrong is wrong? One thing has happened now in the United States. The woman, their primate, who has been leading them in that evil direction, I think he ran into trouble with them. Because she taught them that the American Anglican Church does not need spiritual salvation. That it's not necessary. That there is no need for any idea of personal salvation. And so the people say, no. That will contradict everything that they have ever known about Christian theology. Because what it simply means is to wipe away the idea of sin. Because the idea of salvation is based on teaching that the Christian, I mean that human beings have depraved nature. And that depraved nature needs to be redeemed. So if you say there is no need for that salvation, you have cancelled out sin, you have cancelled out everything that has to do with human nature. And so even the Genesis 3, 2 and 3 will be removed. Because there will be no need to talk about the fall. It means everybody is good enough. But the people were not able to take that type of teaching in spite of their condition. They are very sick condition. They were able to know that this is not good, though. And so they say, oh yeah, madam, they go. Find their way. May the Lord fight his battle. Amen. In addition to all this, there is the issue of the end time, Antichrist, and political oppression. If you go through all the passages like Ida was speaking to us, you will see that certain things will happen during the end time. And you will see the struggle for nuclear power. That somebody is not able to feed himself. He's spending all his money to acquire a nuclear weapon. The management of nuclear facility is no small matter. If you will pay attention, you remember the Chernobyl accident. For years and years to come, over 60 years to that place, nobody can live there. And the accident that happened with the nuclear reactor in Japan, up to today, they are not able to control it. And people who are struggling to feed themselves are working hard to acquire nuclear weapons. So one day they will just wake up, an accident has happened, their population will be wiped out. There are some signs which the Bible describes. The Bible describes these signs. When you look at the nitty-gritty or the details of these signs, they give you the impression that they look like a nuclear accident. The moon will not shine, the sun will close down, everything will be shaken. I remember the day on the main market got bombed during the Civil War. For about 50 kilometer radius, the rain that fell that day was nothing but soot. Was dark, completely black, because of the smoke from the market. So, it's something you need to take note of. When you read it, look at it, examine yourself, and be ye steadfast. In our local environment, we have other challenges that call the Christian to be steadfast. And what is that? False teaching, like it has been mentioned. We now have great men of God, not great God. The men are more important than God himself. So, man of God, or the great man of God, is now a teaching. And if you say anything against the great man of God, you will be cast out into outer darkness. Because your sins will not be forgiven. This man of God can teach whatever catches his fancy. He does not worry whether it is in line with the scriptures or not. He is the man of God. We have it in all left, right, and center in our environment. Somebody who is a breakaway catechist or lay leader establishes his church. 2 years later, is an archbishop. And then he starts to pontificate, to teach what he does not know. And then he will be ordaining people. In other words, he will be exchanging ignorance, transferring ignorance to those people who generate. So the ignorance has been set in motion. It will be rolling from one man to the other, and so on and so forth. When you have an environment saturated with this type of life, things are not all right. Things are not all right. We now have people in the bus. That is their church. They stand up after preaching. They collect tithes. They collect offering. Not one. Oh, you pay tithe first, then you pay offering, and you sow seed in the bus. And they even do Thanksgiving now in the bus. It is very clear that something is happening. We are really steadily moving into the end time, into the hell days of the end time. And it calls for people to be steadfast in the faith they have received from the fathers. Politicians, on their own, are trying to turn everything against human beings. Selfishness is being enthroned as a doctrine. It is what suits them that suits everybody. If it doesn't suit them, then it's not correct. As long as the clan, the political clan, is comfortable and happy, then the rest, it will be okay for them. That is why some people have said, do not kill yourself with saying you belong to a social party or social party, and this is the party that is going to do this or is doing this. There are only two parties. You know the two parties? Those who are in charge of whatever political party and the rest of us. That is to say, whether you belong to APP or TTC or VVC or NDP, whatever party you belong to, all of them are eating together. They are sharing together. All the ganging up, and they are nothing but political maneuvering. And they are looking for political space. Where do I put my leg so that I will get my own? It's not about you. It's not about how to make things better for you. It's about how they will get a space for themselves. So when you allow yourself to be deceived, and you become a political thug, and you begin to beat people, you begin to fight, you are only being foolish. Because after the man has taken the office, phone him. I'm not even saying go there. Phone him. Well, the network will not go. Then you begin to ask yourself, like the psalmist, in vain have I afflicted my soul. So, all these things are happening. That, like the Bible says, people now become lovers of themselves more than lovers of God. Their principle of pleasure, hedonism, has become their God. And so, acquisition, consumerism has become their God. When you live in an age and context like this, you cannot but be steadfast. Because let me remind you, if you lose your faith you've lost your anchor. And when a ship loses its anchor, what happens? It goes adrift. So, we live in a sea of evil. And if you don't have an anchor, you will be adrift. Knowing, not going to the east, not going to the west, and so on. You don't know where you are going. But one thing is clear. Here, we have no continuing city. We seek the one that is to come. So if that is what you are doing, then be steadfast in the faith of our fathers. It is very important that I remind you of some of the things which militate against steadfastness in Christ. Particularly those of us in the ministry. Some of us have no sharp understanding of our sense of call. Maybe you cannot really know whether you are called or you are not. But you like the work. And maybe it runs in your family. And you have inherited it. If this is your pedigree, the tendency is to get frustrated. Because you do not really know why you are there. You are struggling to maintain a family record or family history. You say in our family, somebody is always a priest. But if God has called you, it might be dark, it might be bright, it might be tough, it might be easy. You will get there. Because you will remember that you did not ask yourself to do this work. The one who has sent you, He made a promise, "Lo, I am with you always, to the close of the age." So even if you are in the bush, or you are in the city, or you are this and that, you are a bishop, or you are not a bishop, or you are not even a reverend, a venerable, or a canon, the Bible says, "Out of Egypt have I done what? Have I called my son?" If the Lord wants to give you, He will look for you. He will send those people to go and call you. And they will come and say, "Look at you. They are looking for you. Where are you? Where have you been since?" Then you say, "Who are the people looking for me?" And I say, "Keep quiet. Let's go. Because the time has come." So, I want you to know that if you are not called and your concern is the bread you are going to eat, like Jesus told those people, you are not looking for me because you heard the word, but because you have eaten of the loaf. If that is the loaf is your problem, you will eat. And it is people like this, as soon as they are leaving college, they are busy strategizing. Where will I go now? I will tell my parents to go and beg so-so-so bishop. To go and beg so-so-so person. I want to go to that diocese. So that they will buy me stereo equipment. In my house there will be television, plasma TV, stereo, and all this thing. So he has opportunity to fill his mind with polluted things. That is his concern. On Sunday, he has no job. He's busy reading epistle. The epistle is taken from so and so. And tell me, is it reading epistle that's why you decided to go for training? You don't need to go for training to read epistle. You You don't need to go. You don't need Emmanuel College. You don't need Trinity College to read the epistle. Now the women in the congregation, the men in the congregation, they read the epistle. And why not? But if in fact you have been trained for something spectacular, give yourself to it. Go the extra mile. Another thing that is afflicting us and militating against steadfastness is what has come to light in our church in recent times. And that is the fact that even though it's a material thing, it has a way of impinging upon the spiritual. It has that aspect. And that is the fact that some dioceses, there is negligence in the payment of clergy's salaries and stipends. Now, we observe that Nehemiah was a general. But Nehemiah was what? As long as we fail to pay the salaries and the allowances of our clergy as at when due, we will be lepers. It is a terrible situation. The reason is that you humiliate the man of God. He has a wife. He has children. They go to the university. And in the university environment, which is very corrupt, assuming he has two daughters in the university, how can he, as a father, speak to the children and say, keep away from evil in the campus? How? When he has no money to give them to buy food. He has no money to give them to pay for accommodation. He has no money to give them to buy even simple dress. So when she sees people going for political party this at midnight, will she not follow? And if she follows, evil communication will do what? We corrupt good manners. So, those of you, whether in the diocesan board or in any forum, any fora of the church, in your diocese, it must be spoken loud and clear that it is an evil not to pay people their salaries. We must not, there is no church in the Anglican Communion where this is tolerated. The people we see in Africa and other parts of the nation, it doesn't happen that at the end of the month you owe the people. It's not only a moral problem, it is also criminal. Because if you hire somebody, you must pay him. If you don't pay him, he takes you to court. So we must, all of us, join hands together as members of the diocesan board to ensure that whatever development you are doing, the clergy of the diocese, the diocesan workers, must be paid. Otherwise, it will be difficult to be steadfast. It will be difficult to be steadfast. How will the man be steadfast? Is he going to continue to fast? I want to appeal to you. Join the crusade in your diocese that salaries must be the first charge before any other thing. If you develop structures and the human beings are not developed, you have not done anything. When I was in the army, we were taught that human being is the first defense equipment. Not machine. Not a tank. Not ferret. Not panhard. Not rifle. Not bullet. The first equipment for defense is the human being. That is why welfare matter in the army or in the military is number one. If the man who is to operate the gun or do all this is okay, if his head is correct, if his head is correct, every other thing will be correct. When you ask him to jump that fire, he will jump it. He will not see the danger at all. But when you are busy pushing people, pushing a man who is hungry, can't you go? Go now. Go. What type of teaching of evangelism with a man whose daughter is stranded, whose son is ashamed? I was one day, you know this All Saints Onitsha, we used to collect money for that church. And I did not pay as a boy. I came to school. And we were asked to, those of you who have not paid, stand up. And incidentally, the teacher was a junior brother to my mother. And how much were we looking for? 4 shillings. So we were asked to stand up. I was waiting that this man will ask me to sit down. He did not ask me to sit down. More than that, we were asked to go home. And that we should not come back until we bring it. And my father told me it will take a week before I will get that 4 shillings. And it took that 1 week. Not only that, when I came back with the money, I didn't feel okay. It was a big shame for me to be sent out. So what of a priest, a venerable, a canon, a reverend, ordained by the church and the people of God? And the daughter cannot pay. The son cannot pay. And then you are presiding over it. And you say you are busy with your this thing. Go and pray. Remember James. He said, faith without work is what? We must join hands with our leaders in the diocesan board to make this matter a front burner, a priority. If we don't do it, it will affect the future of this church. It will affect it in a very serious way. Because the idea of a diocese here, diocese this, cannot work. Cannot work. Furthermore, undue rivalry. There is undue rivalry. Just as in the parable of the sower, the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches can remove our gaze from the cross and make us to stumble. Our inability to wait for God's time and unguarded desire to be like others will always make us a prey of the enemy. We should desire spiritual blessings more than the materials. And so, food is essential. Materials for the body is essential. But do not worship them. Some of us have gone beyond the level of need to what we want. And human want have no limit. Do you know that we have thieves in the church? Among the clergy, we have thieves. We have thieves who steal offering. Oh yes. Like the children of Samuel. He said, give me to the priest or I take it by force. Every thanksgiving is a special one for this one is reserved. Don't count this one. This one, don't count this one. Not this one. Not this one. You cannot hide it from God. You cannot hide it from God. You may cover your sins so that no one may see. Cannot hide it from God. Knowing the Lord of the harvest, we must know the Lord who has sent us. Otherwise, we miss the mark. He is the anchor, and we hold on to him as the author and finisher of our faith. The clergy and wife combined ministry. I do not want to read anything here, just to tell you that the moment you join with your husband, you are the minister together. That's the way we inherited it. That the pastor's wife is a pastor. The vicar is in charge. The wife is one of the ministers of the church. And so, we give her respect. We give her respect. And she's part of the ministry. The idea of asking your wife to go away, to be thousands or hundreds of kilometers away, while you are where you are, facing the temptations of this world, is not something to be commended. Some of our wives are so busy and they are far away, and they expose the man to all the temptations of this world. And when the man falls, they come round to blame him, and so on and so forth. We are together in this ministry. Some of you married before you came into the ministry. We can understand your difficulty, that your wife did not have the understanding that you are going into the ministry. But nothing takes God unawares. It had been part of the plan for your life before the foundation of the earth. So, if God allows it to happen to you, it has been planned by God. It has been pre-planned. And you should fit into it through prayers and the mighty mercy and grace of God. There are some of us, we eat Anglican food, we drink Anglican water, we are Anglican clothes, and everything around us is all Anglican. But we are not prepared to serve this church. The church is doing 100% for us, but we will still abandon it and travel to Kano, travel to this, travel to that. We will not be available to render any service to the church. So if you are one of those who say to your husband, "Now you then make a reverend, not me," I want you to know that you are getting it wrong. The house where you live, the water you drink, the dignity you enjoy, is all a gift of grace. Let not the grace of God in your life be in vain. Brothers and sisters in Christ, men and women who have gone ahead of us, never found it easy. We have biblical examples as well as examples from the history of the church. If they could remain steadfast, then it's a challenge to us. We can, by the grace of God. We have the assurance that God will not let us be tempted beyond what we can bear. And in the midst of every temptation, we will always make a way of escape. When God gives a task, He supplies the strength needed so that man is inexcusable. Let us be fixed, unchanging, steady, firmly loyal, constant, unswerving, and immovable as we run the race that is set before us with perseverance, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of God. By the way, is there any of you who is 150 years old here? years old. Please stand. Let's clap for you. Do you see the point I'm making? We will soon go. We are on transit. We are on transit. After some time, you will not be there. After some time, I will not be there. When my mother died last year, I went to the mortuary at Asaba to go and see. When I entered, look, it's quite a community. I'm telling you. It's a community of dead people. Lying in different shapes and sizes, the big ones, the small ones, the old ones, the young ones, those with half body. Then it occurred to me when I saw my mother, all the glow in her face gone, the beauty gone, everything gone, just in a motionless position. Then I say, my God, this will be the lot of everyone. Prepare to meet your God. In the name of God the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.